Okay, good evening all. Thanks for coming. I've got to say, I'm impressed with how many people are here. So this is me. I was a hostage in Iraq. This was taken about 6 months after I was captured in March of 2007. So first of all, I'm from the city of Lincoln, which is in the north for all of you in the south. Okay, there is an existence above there. I was actually born in Leicester, but I moved to Lincoln when I was really young. I was in the Scouts, excelled at that, got Chief Scout Award, Queen Scout Award, really proud of all that stuff. And then I went to Nottingham to do my bachelor's degree in information technology, and I then went on to do my master's degree in Norwich in computer science. Basically, it was during my master's degree that I got this idea that you could go and work abroad. You know, great. I had all sorts of images of lounging on a beach, you know, drinking pina coladas, getting paid vast sums of money for it. That didn't really happen. So the first job that I got offered while at Norwich was working in China. And I applied for a number of positions, and I was offered the chance to go to China on a local higher salary. And I thought, yeah, that's great, I can do that. And I was offered two places. I was offered Beijing and Chengdu. Well, I'd heard of Beijing. You can see it on the map. So I spoke to a lot of people about it. They all said, go to Beijing. It'd be the better option, the easiest option. You'll fit in much better there. So I went to Chengdu instead, which kind of set the scene of my life. It was great. You know, I was working in a university there. I was teaching computer science. I was teaching programming in Java. I saw panda bears, you know, yeah, bicycles, Chairman Mao, did all the stuff. Learned to use chopsticks, everything. Went back to England after about 18 months and got a job with the ambulance service in Lincoln, thinking that I'd sort of got rid of my travel and, you know, I was going to settle down, get married, have a dog and all that sort of thing. I think I must have been working in Lincoln for all, you know, about a month before I got bored and realised that I wanted to go and do other things. So I started looking around for other jobs. Again, in my mind, high salary, beaches, pina coladas, driving Ferraris in my Armani suits and all that sort of thing. Those jobs don't really exist, I now know, okay. So I applied for a lot of jobs, but in the end, I couldn't get one. I didn't have the experience, didn't have the skills. So I got offered a position with voluntary services overseas that put volunteers into international, into developing countries. And I remember I got offered a few countries. I got offered South Africa, Eritrea, where else? Egypt, I think, was one of them, and Guyana. So I pull out my map of Africa. Yeah, I can see South Africa, I can see Eritrea, I can, you know, see Egypt, all these other countries. Looking at Africa, I can't find Guyana at all. Did a bit of Googling. Guyana's part of the Caribbean. Where, hey? So. Needless to say, no one had ever heard of Guyana either, so I applied for that job. Did a bit more research, found out it was on the mainland coast of South America, and it's actually 6 feet below sea level. Holland's below sea level, it's not famous for its beaches. Guyana is also not famous for beaches. So for those of you that don't know, this is where it is. There's actually a guy in the audience that was actually in Guyana with me for years. Gavin, wherever you are. Where are you? Yeah, you're at the back. You're at the back. So I met Gavin a couple of years after I first arrived. And yeah, we've known each other since. It used to be British Guyana. It used to be part of the British Empire. And it got its independence in 73. Yeah? Maybe. Was it 73? Yeah, I don't think there's any other Guyana experts here. Anyway, whatever.
Keep talking.
Yeah, okay. So, so it got its independence and it's now part of the Commonwealth. This is Kaichur Falls, by the way. It's the largest single drop waterfall in the world, allegedly. If you've ever been to Niagara, it's absolutely nothing like that. This thing is massive. Right in the middle of the jungle, you can stand in the fall. It's obviously, that's dangerous, but you can do it, okay. So it was while in Guyana, I was on this volunteering position. I was basically assigned to the Lands and Surveys Commission, which is like the Ordnance Survey. And that's where I started dealing with spatial data. So I was working with SQL Server databases. At this time, it was SQL Server 2000. But I was dealing with data vector shapes, okay? And I was dealing with how to store vectors into a database. So I was using Map Info was the product. It's like Esri ArcGIS, but the other company. Okay. So I did that. I did my volunteering for, 2.5 years. It was only supposed to be a 2-year placement. I ended up staying on a little bit. And then in 2005, there was a massive flood. And I got reassigned to the Flood Relief Secretariat. And that dealt with flood relief claims. And I was asked to stay on for another year. Sort of said, yes, I'd do that. And then from that, I was offered a job of head of IT of the Mining Commission. They had no IT whatsoever and wanted to computerize the whole commission. That was the remit, computerize our commission. Guyana is very famous for gold diamond mining. A lot of gold comes from Guyana. So the Mining Commission was responsible for issuing permits for mining. And I got reassigned there. And I was there for another year and a half, okay? So by this time, we're coming up end of 2006, early 2007. Reality starts to hit. You know, this volunteering work, it's great for the soul, but terrible for the bank account. My student loans were in default. You know, I'd kind of fled the country, you know, shredded all my British addresses and everything, trying to get away from it. But that student loans company, damn, they're impressive. They're better than the NSA. So I thought, you know what, I better do something about this before, you know, I get some people with baseball bats coming and knocking on my door. So I started applying for other jobs. And by this time, having spent, four or five years in Guyana, I was deemed to be more of an expert than I was before. And I swear to this day, I was looking at the internet and I saw an advert for a job, and I'm sure it said in the islands, and it was with a company called Bearing Point. I'd heard of Bearing Point. They had office in the Dutch Antilles, which is the Caribbean coast up here. And it sounded good. So I applied. The next thing, I get a phone call from Bearing Point saying to me, this job's in Iraq. I was like, Iraq? I don't remember being in Iraq. It said the island. So I look back at the advert. Sure enough, it said, you know, looking for a database developer in Iraq. Like, my brain, I'm sure, said the islands anyway. So I thought about it a lot. And I also got offered a job in Zimbabwe at the time for 3 months. And I remember sending an email to my family in England and said, hey, I've been offered this job in Zimbabwe. What do you think? Oh, they went, no, don't go. It's really dangerous, all the rest of it. So I thought about the Iraq job. So the first thing I did was not tell anyone, because obviously they were going to give me a lot of grief. And I accepted it. I mean, it was a permanent job with Bearing Point based in Washington, D.C. I wasn't a contractor or anything like that. I was a direct employee. And, you know, it was a 3-month job in Iraq, do that, go back to Washington, D.C., sit in a cushy office for the rest of my life. What could possibly go wrong, right? So I thought about it, and you know, a lot, as I say, and this is some of the reasoning behind it. It wasn't a military job. I was working for a private company that was doing aid development in Iraq. And that sort of appealed to me. I wanted to work in developing countries and international development. So I was training the IT staff, very similar to the sort of work I'd been doing in Guyana. Although I'd been developing these databases, I was training a counterpart as well. So I that was good. Yeah, my student loans. For some reason, by this point, I'd convinced myself that I wanted post-conflict experience. I don't know why I thought that. That was just some reason in my head. The unfortunate thing is I still don't have post-conflict experience. What I have now is in-conflict experience. So I still never got that. Yeah, you know, working in international development, I wanted to make a difference. I want to, you know, get rid of starving kids and, you know, all that sort of thing. So, you know, going to Iraq, I thought, although it's not going to stop the war, it might just check something on a huge list, you know, make one step closer. I'd never been to the Middle East, obviously. Good reason to go. Never been there. And also, I'm interested in learning languages and culture and, you know, tasting food and all that sort of thing. But the real main thing that did it, really, was I was playing this ridiculous game with all the other sort of people around me, all these other expats. I can't even believe I'm explaining this to you. So all of us that work overseas, we play this game. And the idea is to live and work in a country beginning with every letter of the alphabet. So like you'd live and work in Australia, Belgium, Canada, Denmark. Okay. So the problem was, at this time, we used the British and Foreign Wealth Common Office website. We've got to use a list. There's got to use some list, so we use the British one. And There was no country beginning with W. West Germany didn't exist, Western Samoa had gone. So the chairman in charge of this game, there is an order, said that W could be a war zone. Okay, this works. The problem was, Iraq wasn't actually a war zone at that point in 2007. It was in war, but it wasn't anymore a war zone. So I raised the question, I said, look, you know, if I go to Iraq, do I get a W for working in a war zone? The answer came back that if you're stupid enough to go to Iraq and something happens and you mention Guyana in your release interviews, we will give you the W. I still speak to those friends today. Okay, so the company that I work for, I should explain something here. Is anybody from Bearing Point? There's a Bearing Point office in London. Is anyone here from Bearing Point? No, okay. This is a bit of a legal disclaimer, I guess. So I worked for Bearing Point, okay? It was, the head office was based in Washington, D.C. They had offices all over the world, including London, Europe, etc. However, the company went bankrupt in 2007, obviously unbeknown to me. And the European division did a management buyout. They had the rights to the logos and the name, okay? So this logo is my logo, but it's also the logo of London. But it's a different office, all right? The London office and European Bearing Point is like the child of who I work for, okay? So disclaimer over. Is that good? Where's Joe? Is that work?
Not the same Bearing Point now. Different company.
Old. Right. So there we go.
We'll stick something on the video to cover our...
Okay. So at the time, Bearing Point was one of the top 10 largest IT consultancies in the world. They specialised in emerging markets. My division was the emerging markets group. It actually had been an independent company that Bearing Point had bought out a couple of years earlier. They were based in DC, and they had offices worldwide, as I say, in the Caribbean. You know, I'd met them in Dutch Antilles, and that's where I knew them from. What I didn't know until I got to Iraq was they also provided staff to the CIA. I didn't know that. The militia knew that, but I didn't. Okay. And ultimately, they went bankrupt in 2009. Okay. Again, obviously, I didn't know that. So what was I doing there? Well, I was working in the Ministry of Finance data center. Now, this is not to be confused with, on the news, you see in Baghdad, the Ministry of Finance is a massive building, keeps getting blown up, it's huge. That's not where I worked. I worked in a data center that was miles away from there. It's part of the university compound. It's all very nice, you know, safe. It was great. It was a nice place. I was working in the red zone, but living in the green zone. So where I lived technically was kind of safe. Again, what I didn't really appreciate was I was expecting sort of the green zone and then a yellow zone and then an orange zone and then a red zone. It wasn't like that. Green, red. Whole of Iraq was red. The green zone is really small. I'll show you the map in a minute. Primarily, I was developing reports from the financial management system. They'd had this system in, I think, since 2005, and the American government was constantly asking them to produce reports on their spending, which they hadn't done. They said the reporting module wasn't working, so I was sent over there to work on it. Just by coincidence, it's actually the same system that's used in Guyana, but that's by the by. I never worked on it in Guyana. I also did some other work, an employee census database that I was working on. And this, I think, was really the red flag for our abduction. A lot of people think this is what did it. And there's a lot of talk in the press about how I was tracking billions of dollars going missing. I never got that far. I wasn't there long enough. But this government employee census database, what you have in a lot of these countries, in Guyana, developing countries, one person will take a salary from two ministries. So there'll be a teacher, but they'll also be a cleaner of a hospital, okay? And they'll take double salaries, even though they're only doing one job. This is illegal, it's fraud, right? You can't do it. So you can sort of get it in England a little bit, where the director puts the wife on the payroll, you know, to limit taxes and stuff like that. So I was creating this database to combine all these government employees together and filter out the phantom ones. And I think that was a trigger point. That would have really directly hit these militias because that was their salaries. They were police officers and teachers. They were police officers and doctors. So, you know, I think that. And the idea was to create this centralized government payroll system. even now that never happened. I mean, even in the UK, we don't have a centralized government payroll system, right? I mean, that was probably a step too far. And I was also asked to work on a procurement system, which I never even started, so didn't get to that at all. So this is our red zone. Oh, I haven't bothered putting in the red, okay, because you won't see anything. That's the green zone there, and this is the boundary of Baghdad, and everything else was just red. So yeah, it was not a great place at the time. For some reason, I don't know why I took this, but I took a photo of my room before I got abducted. It's bad quality because I used film back then. You know, before digital cameras, you had a windy thing. No, yeah, okay. This is my body armor number 13. And they said to me, you know, I could black that out. And I thought, nah, having 13 on your chest, that's got to be lucky, right? Yeah. Okay, so I'd been in Iraq for less than 6 weeks. I arrived in Iraq on April the 2nd, 2007. I remember it so clearly. I walked off the plane, and just as we got on the runway walking towards the check-in with immigration, this missile came over, boom, and all this smoke came up. I just remember thinking, welcome to Baghdad. Okay. So it took a while to get permits and all that sort of thing. I'd actually only been working at the Ministry of Finance in this data center for 2 weeks. All of a sudden, door bursts open. I hear someone shout, get down. Everyone in my room stood up. So I stood up because I didn't want to be the odd one out. Unfortunately, when I stood up, I was right next to the door. Door opens. There's a Ministry of Interior police officer there. Now, each ministry in Iraq has their own police force. So Ministry of Health, Ministry of Transport, Ministry of Interior. Bit of a standoff. I look at him. He looks at me. I look at him again, puts a gun straight to my head. Now, what I remember about it was not the gun pointed at my head. He had a machine gun slung over his arm. I remember looking at the barrel of the machine gun, and it's pointing right at my groin. I just remember thinking, if that machine gun fires, this is really going to hurt. So I did what anyone else would do. I smiled and put my hands up. What else can I do? And he said, come on. So I step outside, expecting to see my four British bodyguards. I had personal security detail, four armed guards. I step outside, I see no one. There's none of my people are there. There's like police officers all over the place. You know, there's shouting going on, everything. So I walk towards the entrance of the Ministry of Finance, and I see the team leader there of my security team being beaten up by these five other police officers. They're pulling his machine gun away and everything. So I'm like, what do I do? He's like, just do whatever they say. That's the best advice you have as a security guard, just do what they say. I was like expecting, you know, I don't know, MacGyver, you know, kung fu kick these people or something, you know, do something. And then I was stood there while they're disarming this guy. And then the phone rang, and it was a bit of a Nokia moment, you know, just for that split second, everything stopped. Everyone like, what is that? Oh, it's a phone. And then they just all started again. And what it was in the car park, one of the security guards, my security guards in the car park, hit a panic button that had sounded an alarm back at the headquarters in the green zone, and they were trying to call the team leader to find out what was going on. So, that's what had gone on there. They led me outside, and there was a whole stream of Iraqi police vehicles, easily 20 vehicles. Some were driving off in the distance, the rest were all parked up here. I got put in the back seat of a car. The team leader got unceremoniously thrown into the boot of it. It was like some sort of Toyota, like hatchback thing. And there's about six or seven police officers in this car, and they show me their IDs, like police, you know, okay. And we zoom off, lights going, sirens going. I thought at this point we were actually under arrest. I thought maybe it was a document infringement, maybe something wrong with the ID, something like that. And we're driving along, and they start taking my clothes off and throwing them out of the window. Now, having worked in South America, I've seen corrupt police practices. I've never seen anything like this. I think at that point, I knew this was an abduction. And what really cemented that was I had a load of dollars, like, I don't know, maybe $500 in my pocket to pay some expenses to staff. And I gave them the money And they just threw it out the window. I thought, that's it, you know, we're being abducted. They did miss one person. There was another IT guy next door. They missed him. He went to the toilet. This militia stormed the building, came out the toilet. Where's everyone gone? I spoke to him after I got released. I said, I hope you bought a lottery ticket that day. This is our WikiLeaks entry, by the way. I actually tried accessing this in the UK. So in Guyana, in South America, I can access this, no problem. But here in the UK, it didn't exist anymore. So I don't know whether it's blocked or not. But I pulled that off our WikiLeaks. You can see it all dressed in uniforms, blah, 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 driving 30 Land Cruisers. Yeah, great. Okay, so we drive off and we stop in this... in this marketplace, basically. I get out, I'm in my underpants. I see the other four guards next to me, and we're put in the back of a minibus. The four guards are all handcuffed and got those flexi grip things on. I haven't got anything, I'm just... You know. So they actually took my hands and bound them with cloth. And we drive along a little bit, and this other guy, an Iraqi, gets in the vehicle. He's wearing an American military uniform. And I remember seeing TS on his arm, and that's a translator. And I recognized the guy. He was a brother of an Iraqi that I worked with. And I said, do you speak English? He said, no. I was like, okay. So we drive off, bus stops, we get out the bus. We all get blindfolded. We get led upstairs into this room. And I can hear the four British guards talking. One of them, I thought, had got a dislocated shoulder. He was like, ow, oh, ow, my shoulder. Ah. Turns out it wasn't the case. It was the handcuffs were too tight. But anyway, and with that, I hear him getting sort of walked away. And there's a gunshot. And we're like, have they just killed someone? Did they kill him? And the British guard said, no, they didn't kill him. Apparently, when you kill someone, you get a gurgling sound. And they said, we didn't hear that. He's fine. So, you know, I'm still processing all of this. With that, they picked me up, walked me out the building. You know, I'm thinking, oh, this is it, the end. And halfway downstairs, there's a gunshot in a room in the back. You know, it was just a scare tactic. So we get put in a vehicle. And basically, we're put into this, myself and two of the guards. These two here were put into a false compartment at the back of a Bedford truck, and we were in there for 2 days. It was really hot. I remember it was really narrow. It was like I had to sit like this. I had my knees up. I had one of the guards back on my knees, and the other guy was sat with his back to the wall. And we were blindfolded. I mean, you know, I tentatively lifted it up. Where are we? And I could see, like, through the weld gaps in the back of the truck we were driving along, you know, I could see the sunlight through it. It was pretty rough. So, these guards, well, I always want to say, you know, these were great guys and were best buddies, all that sort of thing. I didn't know them. I didn't know them at all. This guy I was actually with for 6 months, held with him for 6 months. And it became very apparent we didn't actually have a lot in common. So I was kind of a little bit happy when I got separated from them. He was actually the team leader. These were all killed. Most of these bodies were released in 2009. This guy eventually got, his body was released, I think, in 2012. So the basic abduction timeline. As I say, on our first day, we got put in the back of the false compartments of these trucks. I mean, we were transported down to Basra. It took like a day. This was all backtrack. It was not on like asphalt highway. And it was really hot. I mean, it was phenomenally hot. It was really, really hot. And then myself and the team leader, we were held together. The four guards were split into two groups of two for some reason. And then I sort of got transferred between those two groups for the first 6 months. I don't really know why they did that. But principally, we were held by police officers from the Ministry of Health and Ministry of Transport down in Basra. And they made no bones about it. There's a lot of stories in the press saying they were disguised as police, all this sort of stuff. These were real McCoy police officers. They were also militia, but there were real police officers as well. Okay, it's a bit like, I always say, it's a bit like being a scout leader and a teacher. They're not mutually exclusive, right? You can be one and the same. So you can be a police officer and in the militia. I was down there I was down in Basra for sort of 6 months, something like that. Then I got moved up to Hilla, which is midway between Baghdad and Basra. Was held there for about a month. We were told we was going to be released and all this sort of stuff. That never happened. We then got moved back down to Basra. Don't really know why they did that. And then in December, I got separated off, and that was the last I saw of those British guards. I never saw them again after that. In 2008, I was held with these two Americans. This guy, Sergeant El Tai, he was the only American to be classified as missing in action. I didn't know that at the time. I knew he was an Iraqi. I knew he'd been educated in America. I knew he was working for American forces. But I didn't know he was the only missing in action soldier. And this guy, Michael Chand, was an ex-Marine. He was captured by the militia in an ambush. They were driving along, and there was an IED, blew up his vehicle, and he rolled into a ditch. And he saw the police, the Iraqi police came down, and he got out and said, "Hey, Iraqi police, help me out." Captured him. I didn't really have much interaction with these people, but I did have a little bit, enough to obviously know who they were. And then in June of 2008, I get moved back up to Hilla on my own. I don't see any other foreigners after that. In 2009, I get moved to Baghdad, and I'm held by the Ministry of Interior Police. Some of these are the same police officers that captured me. It was very interesting. General treatment. You know, I always say 2007 was rough, unnecessarily harsh. The mock execution. I remember it. I always thought, dead or alive, this thing would be over in 6 months, one way or another. You know, I was expecting the SAS to come storming in at any point. Didn't happen. About 6.5 months in, police sergeant from the Ministry of Transport comes in. I'm with the team leader. I've got both feet chained to a grill. Comes in, he handcuffs me, behind my back actually. Takes me off the chain, blindfolds me, leads me outside, kneels me down, puts a gun to my head, clicks it, fires. There's a bang. I hear the discharge. I hear the cartridge falling on the floor. It was like something out of a Hollywood movie. I remember sitting there. I'm dead. And I remember thinking, well, okay, it's not ended how I wanted it to end, but it's over. And then, hold on, reality check. I can hear people laughing. I'm not dead. Get a grip. You're still alive. Get with it. With that, they put me up, picked me up, led me back into the room where the team leader was. He said, "What happened?" I said, "I think they just shot me in the head." And I was so annoyed about it. I always said if I was going to be executed, I was going to show no fear. I was going to be really strong, British stiff upper lip. Knelt me down, put the gun to my head. I started sweating, shaking. I forgot everything. I forgot what I was going to do. It was the most terrifying experience I've ever had in my life. And what was funny about that situation was the image I was going to have in my head was walking the dog as a child in my back garden. I remember as a kid walking the dog. I always thought it was a nice, relaxing thing to do. When I got out, I spoke to my stepdad about it. And he said, "You hated walking the dog. You never walked the dog." I don't remember that. I don't remember it like that. So that was kind of the worst thing that happened to me. I mean, we got beaten up. I had glass smashed in my leg. I mean, you know, we can go on about the great gory stuff if you want to do that later. 2008, my treatment was a little bit better. And I say it was better because I'd been separated off from the team leader that I wasn't getting on with. And this allowed me to interact with the Iraqi guards a little bit more. Although they blindfolded me and made me lie down for about 6 months, I was able to communicate with them a little bit. And that made things a bit better. And ultimately, I mean, I got separated from the others in 2008. 2009, I would say, was pretty good. I had a PlayStation, I had a laptop, I was able to exercise, I was out of the chains, I wasn't in handcuffs, it was okay. And ultimately, of course, I got released. A quick story about having the laptop. So I'm in this room with this laptop, just playing around, playing games on it. And the militia have left the room. So I do a scan on the Wi-Fi, and I find out there's some open Wi-Fi, so I connect onto one of them. And I put in my company address, www.baringpoint.com, website not found. I'm like, what the hell's happened? Unbeknown to me, of course, it had gone bankrupt. Yeah, I was thinking I could access my corporate email and all that sort of stuff. You know, what I really thought had happened, I thought, great, you know, typical IT policies kicked in. You know, I've been absent for 6 months, not changed my password, I'm blocked, you know, that kind of thing. Anyway. So, how did I get through the day? Well, the primary aim of the day was to survive, and I just took one day at a time. In my mind, I felt if this was the release date, every day I lived was one step closer to that release date. But after about a year, I just realized the gap wasn't getting any shorter. I just felt like everything was constantly moving on one day. But as long as I survived that day, I could live for the next day. I tried to keep track of the date, and I was pretty good at this. I remember when they took the blindfold off 13 months later, and I had a TV, I turned on the TV, and I was one day out. And I know where I lost that day. I was really impressed by that, because I'm absolutely useless at keeping dates. I tried to improve my immediate environment. It became apparent to me that every time I got moved, I was moved around every couple of months. Every time I moved, it was a new team of militia. It was apparent they didn't talk to each other. So I was able to say things like to the new militia, I had a TV at my last place, where's my TV? Why have you put me in the chains all day? They used to let me off the chains for an hour a day. You know, then when I moved again, they used to let me off the chains during the day, blah, blah, blah. So I kind of built up my rights like that. I tried to cost them as much money as possible. In my mind, I was thinking financially, this is a financial trace. The reality is, I mean, these militias are getting millions, you know, my little bar of soap, you know, doesn't even show on the radar. But what I would do is wash my hands in shampoo because it was more expensive than soap. And if toothpaste, I would go through once every 2 weeks. If I had any left, I'd squeeze it down the toilet, so they had to buy me new toothpaste. Clothes, you know, I mean, you can wear a t-shirt for a couple of weeks, but after that, I want a new t-shirt. And the water's really bad. When you wash the whites in the water there, it comes out brown. So, you know, I was very keen on making myself look good. They did buy me a French football team tracksuit once, which I objected to. And I do, no one French here. Liability issue, maybe, no, okay. okay, yeah. And I remember they bought this t-shirt for me. They said, look, genuine Nika, not fake, genuine. N-I-K-A, swish. Oh yeah, you're real genuine, yeah. I tried to leave as much evidence that I was in that house as I could. So when I was running up and down the width of the room, so this room's like a 5 meter width. So every day I would do 1,500 jogs of that width, okay? And I would put my hands on the wall each time to try and leave handprints. And then during the day, what I would do is pick skin off my feet and flick it around the room. So if anyone ever found it, they could try and find some DNA of me. I tried to find out as much as possible about the militia, and this is really what the guards said to me. They said, remember the layout of your rooms, and remember, try and get information on people. So, having worked in developing countries, it's not like being in England. In England, you would say, oh, what's your job? What do you do? Where do you work? That's not your opening line. In these developing countries, your opening line is, are you married? Do you have children? How old are they? What do they do? That sort of thing. So I was able to find out quite a lot about their marriage, their kids. I mean, you know, I was held for so long by some of these people that, you know, they had wives that got pregnant, had a baby, miscarriage, blah, blah, all the traumas of normal life, you know. You know, I had some where the parents had been killed and all sorts of stuff. The Iraqis had some pretty horrific stories, I've got to be honest with you. And I tried to create mental stimulation initially by keeping up my mosquito kill ratio. So, you know, you're handcuffed, all right, and there's mosquitoes buzzing around. So I tried to kill, on average, 5 mosquitoes a day. That's really difficult, all right, because, you know, you're like this, right? It's not easy. But I tried to do it. Increase the size of my fluff ball. Man, so I used to pick off bits of fluff off my shirt, and I used to roll it into a ball. I mean, after about 4 or 5 months, I had a, like, it was an ace. They threw it away. They thought I'd got something in it, so that was the end of that. And talk about your family first. Like I say, we talk about, are you married? Do you have kids? And all that sort of thing. Now, what happened to me was right at the start of this, they asked us all if we were married. And all my British guards said, yes, they were married, even though they weren't. I didn't want to be, you know, at the front line of the head slicing stakes. So I said I was married also. Of course, over 2.5 years, I've got to build up this marriage. They want to know their name and all this sort of stuff. So, I mean, my wife was great, right? So I ran through all the people that I knew. I mean, I've got to base it on someone, some ex-girlfriend or something like that. And I remember thinking, well, I can't use a British person, too traceable. I'm going to have to use someone from Guyana. And I ran through all the names of people I knew in Guyana, you know, Bendita and people like this. I'm like, I can't spell those names. I've got to pick someone normal. Sorry, Bendita, if you ever watch this. And I remember thinking, Emma was a friend of mine. She was an Amerindian friend, still is a friend. And her last name was Jarvis, and I thought, well, I can't use a real name. But fortunately, I'd seen a movie, Formula 51, some months earlier with the militia, and there was a character in there called D'Souza. So I made up my wife, Emma D'Souza, right? She was a malaria doctor from Brazil. you know, a dad was a doctor, a mum was a teacher. I'd never spoken to the parents because they spoke Portuguese. My Portuguese is not good. I said that we met as part of an Amazonian technical agreement working on the border of Guyana and Brazil, all this sort of stuff. And I remember giving the address of Cop Kwani. You know, like, things were getting a bit serious. The militia wanted to know like addresses and details. So I had to play it a bit careful because I thought, you know, I had images at this point of some British Foreign Office guy running around the Amazon jungle looking for Emma D'Souza. So I thought, well, I better give them a bit of a rogue address. So I actually said they were in the Cop Kwani region of Brazil on the west bank of the Takatu River in Guyana. I knew that anyone reading that address who knew Guyana would know that that was fake. Guyana's actually on the east bank. And to this day, I thought Cap Kwani was in Brazil, but it's not. It's actually a region of Guyana. But anyway, whatever. So I invented this whole wife. And yeah, it was really good. And people ask me about lying and things like that. I don't know whether the art of lying is just making up something so unbelievable it has to be true, because this was just crazy. Or, you know, whether the art of lying is telling a good story, I don't know. Anyway, they believed it. And show religious empathy. So, you know, obviously these people are quite religious, right? So they said to me, do you believe in God? Hell yeah, I believe in God, especially when you shove a gun in my face, I'll believe in anything, right? So they said to me, what are you? I said, well, I'm Protestant. But they didn't know the English for that. They said, what, is that Catholic? So I said, yeah, it's Catholic. Right. I mean, I went to a Catholic church once when I was 5. So I thought, well, I better start doing something Catholic stuff, right? So before I went to bed, I used to just put my hands together and pretend I was praying. And then I thought, hang on a minute, I've got to be good with my timing here. So I used to put my hands together and sort of just count to 10 or something. And then I thought, you know what? I may as well just pray because it's one up from wishing and hoping. So, you know, it's better than nothing, right? So I start doing this. And we actually had some interesting discussions between Catholicism and Islam. Unfortunately, what I now know is it was my misunderstanding of Catholicism and not really any knowledge of Islam whatsoever. But one day they came in with these prayer beads. And they said to me, look, we're really sorry, but we can't get Catholic prayer beads. Can you work with these? I said, yeah, sure. Yeah, that'd be great. So the first thing they did was actually show me how to use them in Islam, which was quite interesting. I learned a bit of Arabic. But yeah, so a few times a day, like 1,000 times a day, I would just sit here going, in my mind, one banana, two banana, three banana, four. It was quite therapeutic, to be honest with you. So that went on for a few months. And then one of the guys that actually spoke pretty good English, the Iraqi, came in. He said to me, as a Catholic person, what do you say? So I remember that one time I went to Catholic church, there was something about Hail Marys. I always thought it was a bit weird. I said, well, you say your Hail Marys. And he brings a laptop over, English Arabic conversion software. Mm-hmm. So I put in Hail Marys, right? H-E-L-L space M-A-R-Y-S. Always thought that was a bit weird. Press enter, nothing found. That's because it's Hail Mary. Fortunately, it's got alternative words at the bottom. So I thought, well, how hard can it be, right? I mean, is anyone Catholic here? I don't mean to offend you. Oh, okay, right. So in my mind, I was like, well, one Hail Mary, two Hail Mary, three Hail Mary. I mean, easy. Click this link. It's a massive prayer. Ah, I'm like, I can't pull it off. I can't lie anymore. So I said to him, I said, look, I'm really sorry, but I learned this when I was a child. I've forgotten it. And I've got to be honest, I've been saying the wrong thing. And I thought he was going to give me a bit of a beating. He said to me, "Ah, that's okay, don't worry." He said, because under Islam, it's not what you do that counts, but it's the process of doing it that God recognizes. I was like, oh, man. So, like, you know, God will recognize me doing that 1,000 times a day. Fantastic, regardless of whatever I say. I was very, very happy with that. So I saved myself a bit of a beating there. I feel like I'd pulled off, like, one of the biggest lies ever in my life. Okay, so some of the things that I tried to remember. My supersonic TruSpec handcuffs that I had for like 2 years, ATL-1-70590. I actually remembered the number in Chinese. I made a point of remembering it in Chinese, so if they ever tortured me, I would just blurt out that number in Chinese. That never happened, but it was always at the back of my mind. I became quite affectionate with my TruSpec handcuffs. I actually contacted TruSpec in America to try and get a trace on that serial number. Told me I'd have to go through a lawyer and they couldn't comment. It's like, okay. I tried to remember the layout of the buildings and actually did a plan for every building that I was held in. I'll show you one of the plans later. Some of them were quite good at showing their ID, but they used to blank out their names and things like that. So I could see it was a police ID and I could see what rank they were, either sergeant or major or something like that. I remember the dates of all the house moves, apart from one that happened in March. I was down in Basra. I remember it distinctly. I completely forgot the date because we woke up to war, basically. What had happened was the Shia militias, the British forces had left Basra, the city of Basra where I was being held. The Shia militias had moved in and the Americans had decided on that day to retake it back. I woke up, there was jets, missiles, the windows were shaking. You could hear not just the bang of the bullet, but the whiz of the bullets going past the window. They moved me straight out of that area immediately. Just bizarre, it's like weird. And I've subsequently met Americans that were involved in that retake. You know, they were like in my street, you know. I remember significant events, you know, bad weather. The idea here was once I got out, I was trying to be able to get locations. My thinking was once I was released, the British military would go in, storm these places, do whatever. Of course, that didn't happen, and we'll look at some of that. So, in my mind, I sort of created this, will there ever be an end? And I mean, yes, it was going to end. I could see it was going to end. The question was, how was it going to end? Things were looking pretty grim. So I've been held 2 years at this point, watching the BBC with my militia. It's BBC Arabic. Gordon Brown comes on the TV, and then it shows a picture of one of my guards. And then it shows a picture of the other four, and then it shows a picture of me with a question mark over it. Basically, what had happened was two bodies had been handed over in March of 2009. No one knew who they were. There was a big debate on the BBC about it. What does this mean? All the rest of it. Following that, someone came to see me, a guy that had been released in exchange for those two bodies. And he said to me, everyone was dead. I was the only survivor. And if I didn't try and escape, I'd get released when his brother got released. Okay, this is not looking really good. So out of all of my things, I'm thinking rescue's out the window. I'm not going to be able to escape. You know, I was by this time, I was really weak. I'm not military trained. I'm in a building with like 20 armed militia. There's no way I'm going to get out. I'm going to die. So the question comes of how am I going to die? I didn't really want to be executed. Never been executed, but I'm assuming it will hurt. I didn't want to do that. I don't like pain. I had been sick a number of times. I had dysentery, and the militia had actually called out a doctor. You know, I'm blindfolded, handcuffed, chained to a grill in a wall. You've got dysentery. You're only allowed to go to the toilet twice a day. That's a real bad mess. Okay. So that's really what I thought was going to happen. I thought I was going to have a heart attack or something like that. But then an opportunity arose. Following the release of these two bodies in 2007, this guy, Laith Al-Kasali, came to see me, the number two commander of the militia. And as I say, he told me everyone was dead. And I said, well, look, you've kept me handcuffed, chained up for 2 years. America didn't keep you like this. Why are you keeping me like that? And he took the chains off and the handcuffs and let me walk around the room. The chain they took off that I'd been wearing for 2 years, they put on a shelf in a cupboard. And in the ceiling was a hook that held a chandelier. And I knew it was strong. The militia would come in every day, put a bar through it and do chin-ups. And I thought it'd be really, really fetching to hang myself using that chain. I thought that would be a good way to go. Principally, my main objective here was to die when I choose and how I choose. So I thought about it a lot and kind of worked myself up. I got it in my mind I was going to do it. But the only real reason I wanted to do it was to hang myself and see the reaction of that militia walking in, seeing me hanging there. Because I'd know they'd be in big trouble for letting that happen. Problem is, of course, if you hang yourself and you're dead, I'm guessing you can't see what's going to happen, what's going on around you. So I found that quite annoying because I can't achieve my objective. So with that, I decided, okay, don't hang yourself. You're not going to be able to see this. Sweat it out, right? Get a grip. They haven't killed you in 2 years. They're probably not going to kill you. So it was after that that I started making my decision to cost them all this money and be a bit more sort of proactive in leaving DNA and things like that. So, in May of 2009, as I say, this guy, Laith Al-Kasali, comes to see me. He's been released from American military prison in exchange for the two bodies. He says to me there's going to be a big release later on. Just hang in there. As long as you don't escape, we won't kill you. I actually got on quite well with this guy. We had a good talk about his family and all that sort of thing. Then in September, they released one body for 100 militants. To this day, I say that was a terrible exchange. And the Foreign Office were involved in the negotiation of that. And I've had talks where the Foreign Office has been there, and I'm like, you should have been disciplined for that. You should have lost your job. This was a real bad deal. This guy comes back to me again in September. He says his brother's not been released as part of that group. As long as I don't escape, he's not going to kill me. And I said, at this point, I said, well, look, you know, your brother's life is in my hands. I can put myself in a position where you have to shoot me. He can't do that. If I die, so does your brother. He will be executed. With that, he got up and left. That was the last time I ever spoke to him. So, I've been held over 2.5 years at this point. I'm watching a Baghdad TV, and I'm watching the news with the militia. And on TV, there's like, it looks like a CCTV camera looking down the side of a building of a vehicle pulling up. And a couple of people get out, and this Iraqi guy gets out. I didn't know who he was. And the militia said to me, that's Blackwater. Now, Blackwater was a covert, a private American security company that did snatch and grab operations. And I said, that's not Blackwater, that's diplomatic. That's not a military vehicle. I didn't really think anything of it. 2 days later, 5 o'clock in the morning, door opens up, I'm asleep. The guy that spoke pretty good English comes into me. He says, get up, you're being released. I was like, go away, it's 5 o'clock in the morning, I'm sleeping, leave me alone. He's like, no, really, you're being released. So I'm like, why? Why am I being released? He said, because our leader's been handed over. You've got to go. We've got to pass you over at 12 o'clock. I'm like, right, whatever. Okay. So I go and have a shower. I cut my hair. What I think is going on is that this militia's had a fight with Al-Qaeda. And I'm thinking that this Al-Qaeda's captured some of the militia and that they're going to exchange me. You know, I'm an exchangeable value. And I was quite up for going to Al-Qaeda. I had kidnap and ransom insurance, so my company would pay for me to be released. Unbeknown, it had gone bankrupt, right? Okay. I don't really believe I'm going to be released. I think it's some sort of strange exchange deal. So with that, I have a shower, cut my hair, do all this stuff. And this is me. They asked me to write this release thing. I have to write this statement. I want to know about my wife's name, wife's address, wife's occupation, my passport number, which I couldn't remember now. I was like 2 years down the line, I was like, I can't remember that. So I did all this, and I've done this before. I've done this like three or four times before. I did this release interview. I just didn't believe it was going on. With that, they blindfold me. No one seemed particularly excited. The guy that spoke English, he'd been holding me now for like a year and a half, and I was kind of expecting a bit of excitement from him, and there was absolutely nothing. I just didn't buy into it. So they blindfold me and put me in the back footwell of this really small car, like a Ford Fiesta or something. It was minute. And we drive off a little bit. And then I get out of the car, take the blindfold off, put some shades on, and put me in the back of another vehicle. And I mean, we're in the middle of Baghdad. I recognize it. We're in the street, you know. We're driving down the road, and we get stopped by an Iraqi army checkpoint. And this soldier walks up to the car, talks to the driver, asks for his ID, walks off. You know, we all sat around for a bit. He comes back, he talks to the driver, talks to the passenger, talks to the driver. I'm like, he's going to ask me a question. I'm not going to be able to answer this. I don't speak Arabic. He looks at me. I'm like, And with that, he just waves the vehicle on. I thought, great, so much for the Iraqi army looking for us. And we drive down the road, not long, maybe only 10, 15 minutes, pull into this driveway. I get out the car, there's cameras everywhere, like tripods all over the place. I walk through this door, and it's this long room, nothing in it, no carpet, apart from a sofa at the end of it, with this guy in a suit sat on it, this guy here. And it's full of people, half of them wearing like militia combat gear, big machine guns, you know, face masked out and all the rest of it. And the other half are just like wearing normal clothes. So this guy gets up, says, Peter Moore? Says, yeah. Says, I'm Sammy Alasky. I work for the Iraqi government. I'm here to take you to the British Embassy. You're a free man. I don't feel very free, you know. So I sit on the sofa. He makes a statement to camera. I get asked to make a statement about how good the militia's been, my treatment's been good. You know, I'll give you 5 stars on TripAdvisor, all that sort of thing. Can't wait to come back. With that, the guy in the suit gets up and walks out the room. So I'm left in this room with all these guys. I mean, I'm really thinking, this is not what it is. This is not what it seems. So I'm told to go. So I get up and I start walking out. And these three guys in military gear stop me near the door, and they turn me around, and two of them are on one side, one's on the other, put their arm around me, and there's another guy stood a couple of meters away. And I can see he's got his hand down his back, and I'm like, this is it, this is where it's going to end. Pulls out a camera, takes a photo, I guess with their Facebook page or something. With that, I'm let go. I'm still not convinced I'm being released. I get in the car, the guy in the suit sat next to me, there's two people in suits in the front vehicle, curly things in their ear, you know, they're talking, the machine guns are there in the car, we drive off. And we're driving along and I can see the doors unlocked, the traffic's really bad, I'm thinking I could escape. But I thought, no, hang fire, because I didn't want to jump out and get shot by the militia behind me. And if it is Al-Qaeda, they'll exchange me for ransom, this is good. We drive about half an hour down the road. I can hear this guy on the phone speaking English. He's like, yeah, he's with me now. We'll be there in 15 minutes, blah, blah, blah. And he said to me, that was the British Embassy. If that was the British Embassy, they'd want to speak to me. No way. We pull into this driveway. I get out of the car, and this British guy walks up to me. Says, hello, Mr. Moore. You're in the British Embassy. We can do anything for you. Couldn't believe it. I always had in my head that when I got released, I'd make some great, profound statement. You know, one small step for man. It'd be on the headlines. I'd make millions from it. You know? I just couldn't believe it was happening. I just wanted to be on my own. And the only place I could think that I could be on my own was the toilet. So my first thing I said when I got released was, I need a pee. The guy's like, yeah, toilet's in there. So I go in the toilet, put my hands on the wall. Stop banging my head on the wall. I'm like, get a grip, you're gonna hurt yourself. Stop, hang on. And I turned around and I turned the tap on and washed my face. I just looked up and there was this whole bank of mirrors. I just remember looking back at myself, thinking you've made it, you've done it, you've beaten the odds. I started crying at that point. So I step out of the toilet, having composed myself and thought about it a bit, realised I have actually got released. And I go into this whole caboodle of stuff that happens in the British Embassy and further on. Immediate medical checks, there's this hot debrief with a whole load of people. Guy walks in from SIS MI6. So we might have to edit that. You might not be able to say that.
No, they know already.
Oh, do they? Oh, okay. Okay. I meet this US Army survival psychologist. I just remember giving him a lot of grief about surviving psychology. I arrive back in England. I look at his report. It's got name, Peter Moore, date of birth, da-da-da. Big white box where you write comments. Show signs of stress. No shit. You went to university for 6 years to learn that? And then I went into 21 days of debrief with SO15. SO15 is like the Metropolitan Police Counterterrorism Unit. It was one of the longest debriefs they ever did. Had psychological checks. I'm psychologically okay, apparently. I'm sane. Spoke to the other families, the other British families. That was quite an interesting situation. We're nearly finished. So, yeah, as part of my debrief, I did one of these diagrams. So I did a diagram of this for each of the rooms I was held in. First observation is I'm clearly not an artist, all right? So I don't know whether you work it out, but this is a bed, and that's me, and there's my little chain from my ankle going to the window. And that's Alan, who's the team leader, with his chain going to the ankle there. There's my TV. Now, these are the two guards. Now, with the two guards, we always called Alpha and Bravo. Apart from these two, they very quickly got renamed to Arsehole and Bellend. These were vicious. These guys were vicious. And because I couldn't see outside, I didn't know the alignment of the room. But what I did on every plan was I put a DOP, direction of prayer. So this is where the direction that they prayed in. And there's various other bits and pieces there. So the militia that took me, a Sebal hack, the League of the Righteous, what are they doing now? This is actually a parade that they were in May 2013. This guy held me for over a year and a half. He was the guy that spoke English. They're now a political party in Iraq. Their leader is democratically elected into the government, the guy I was exchanged with, Qais al-Qasali, and they're now on the ground fighting ISIL. So America is now providing air support for ISIL, for the Sebal hack to fight ISIL. So whereas before they were fighting the Americans, there's now this common enemy. Someone once said, an enemy of my enemy is my friend, and that's definitely the case here, I think. And that's how I sum it up. It's an interesting cultural experience, but not really one that I want to repeat. And that's me flying out. I'm actually in that helicopter flying out. Someone took a photo from the ground. So that's it. Yeah. Break, questions, whatever.
Right. Well, first.